In the dark shadows, in the white cold, fearlessly we search for knowledge new and old. We drink the strong spirits and read the ancient tomes. The order of the Abracast, we are the brave and the bold.
I went back to the beginning. The first case listed was that of Kenneth Arnold, a Boise businessman who had set off the saucer scare. Arnold was flying his private plane from Chehalis to Yakima, Washington, when he saw a bright flash on his wing. Looking towards Mount Rainier, he saw 9 gleaming discs outlined against the snow, each one about the size of a C-54. They flew close to the mountaintops in a diagonal chain-like line, he said later. It was as if they were linked together. The discs appeared to be 20 to 25 miles away, he said, and moving at a fantastic speed. Arnold's estimate was 1,200 miles an hour. I watched them about 3 minutes, he said, and they were swerving in and out around the high mountain peaks. They were flat like a pie pan and so shiny they reflected the sun like a mirror. I never saw anything so fast. This was dated June 24th, 1947. This is an excerpt from a book called Flying Saucers Are Real by Donald Keyhoe, published in 19.
Take control of your destiny. Understand your past, put your present in context, and know your future with a twist. Check out the designs and watch the videos about Abracast Tarot Card Deck on abracast.com. When you order a deck, get a free exclusive bonus tarot card. Also, sign into the mailing list to get a free ebook about the Abracast Tarot Card Deck and other bonus content. Visit the storefront on abracast.com.
Fitty.
The Abracast. Occult, history, conspiracy, and violence.
Hey, welcome to the Abracast. This is going to be a fun Fellowcraft episode. So let me start it by thanking my supporters on Patreon and Subscribestar, or Patreons or Subscribestar. You guys are helping me out so much. I love you very much, all of you. I would marry any one of you fine people. Okay, so from the cold open was from this book, Flying Saucers Are Real, by Donald Keyhoe, and he is talking about Kenneth Arnold's sighting, which kicked off the modern UFO craze. And also right off the bat, we can see some silliness going on here. It is a function. Is it a function of false reporting? Is it a function of media incompetence or straight up misinformation? Because we know when Kenneth Arnold made his report, he never said the craft was saucer shaped. He described them as crescent shaped, or like, I think like a flying wing sort of shape. He said that they moved, quote, like a saucer skipping on water, unquote. This is a bone of contention I have been carrying around with me since I was like a fucking kid. I used to read this Time Life or something, Great Unsolved Mysteries of the Universe book. And on top of their article about this Kenneth Arnold sighting, they had illustrations of what Arnold had reported. And I was always like, they're not even fucking flying saucers. Why does everyone else report that they're flying saucers? So from my point of view, every quote flying saucer unquote story from this point on is at least a suspect for some sort of corruption. But I am going to move on before I ruin it. We're actually going not to be talking a whole lot about Kenneth Arnold tonight. We're going to be talking about the mysterious death. Not mysterious. It's worse than that. The puzzling death of, Captain Thomas, Mantell. So here we go. We're going to get right into it. If you're playing along at home, this is when you should summon your vessel of the art and mix up your preferred weapon of mass distraction in here. And here's, I should look up more toasts. I'm getting tired of the quint toast. So, but here's to swimming with bow-legged women. So yeah, we're jumping into the book now. We're going right to, chapter 2. It has been over 2 years since the puzzling death of Captain Mantell. Mantell died mysteriously in the skies south of Fort Knox, but before his radio went silent, he sent a strange message to Goodman Air Force Base. The men who heard it will never forget it. It was January 7th, 1948, crowded into Goldman Field Tower. A group of Air Force officers stared up at the afternoon sky just for an instant. Something gleamed through the broken clouds south of the base, and high above the field, three P-51 fighters climbed with the swift urgency heading south. They quickly vanished. The clock in the tower read 2:45. Colonel Guy Hicks, the CO, slowly put down his binoculars. If the thing was still there, the clouds now hid it. All they could do was wait. The first alarm had come from Fort Knox when Army MPs had relayed a state police warning. A huge gleaming object had been seen in the sky moving towards Goodman Field. Hundreds of startled people had seen it in Madisonville, 90 miles away. 30 minutes later, it had zoomed up over the base. Colonel Hicks glanced around at the rest of the men in the tower. They all had a dazed look. Every man there had seen the thing as it barreled south of the field, and even though in thin clouds its intermittent red glow had hinted at some mysterious source of power, something outside their understanding. It was Woods, the exec, who had estimated its size. Hicks shook his head. That was unbelievable, but something had hung over Goodman Field for almost an hour. The CO turned quickly as the loudspeaker tuned to the P-51s suddenly came to life. Captain Mantell to Goodman. Tower Mantell to Goodman Tower. The flight leader's voice had a strained tone. "I've sighted the thing," he said. "It looked metallic, and it's tremendous in size." The CO and Woods stared at each other. No one spoke. "The thing's starting to climb," Mantell said swiftly. "It's at 12 o'clock high, making half my speed. I'll try to close in." In 5 minutes, Mantell reported again the strange metallic object had speeded up and was now making 360 or more. At 3:08, Mantell's wingman called in. Both he and the other pilot had seen the weird object, but Mantell had outclimbed them and was lost in the clouds. 7 minutes dragged by. The men in the tower sweated out the silence. Then at 3:15, Mantell made hasty contact. "It's still above me, making my speed or better. I'm going up to 20,000 feet. If I'm no closer, I'll abandon chase. It was his last report. Minutes later, his fighter disintegrated with terrific force. The wreckage, falling wreckage was scattered for thousands of feet. Now, here's a little history lesson about Captain Thomas Mantell Jr. He was a pilot in World War II. He was awarded the Distinguished Flying Cross for courageous action during Operation Market Garden. He was flying a cargo plane, towing a glider, when it came under heavy anti-aircraft fire, and he lost most of his rudder and elevation flaps on his plane. His plane was shot to shit. Instead of releasing the glider early and returning, he drove on and released the glider at the planned point. I mean, this dude flew C-47 Skytrains in the war. He was one of the guys who dropped the 101st Airborne into Normandy. That's the fucking Band of Brothers shit right there. And you watch that, and it's amazing. You just realize the guys flying those planes had gigantic balls. But the thing that lured, when Mantell failed to answer the tower, one of his pilots began searching, climbing to 33,000 feet. He flew 100 miles to the south. But the thing that lured Mantell to his death had vanished from the sky. 10 days after Mantell was killed, I learned of a curious sequel to the Goodman affair. This guy, it's written from this guy's point of view. This is Donald Keyhoe's point of view. An AP account in the New York Times had caught my attention. The story released at Fort Knox admitted Mantell had died while chasing a flying saucer. Colonel Hicks was quoted as having watched the object, which was still unidentified. But there was no mention of Mantell's radio message, no hint of the thing's tremendous size. Though I knew the lid was probably on, I went to the Pentagon when the scare had first broken in the summer of 47. I had talked to Captain Tom Brown, who was handling the saucer inquiries. But by now, Brown had been shifted and no one in the press branch would admit knowing the details of the Mantell saucer chase. "We just don't know the answer," a security officer told me. "There's a rumor," I said. "It's a secret Air Force missile that sometimes goes out of control." "Good God, man," he exploded. "If it was, do you think we'd be ordering pilots to chase the damn things?" "No." And I didn't say I believed it. I waited until he cooled down. "This order you mentioned, is it for all Air Force pilots or special fighter units?" "I didn't say it was a special order," he answered quickly. "All pilots have routine instructions to report unusual items." They had the fighters alerted on the coast when the scare first broke, I reminded him. "Are those orders still in force?" And he shook his head. "No, not that I know of." After a moment, he added, "All I can tell you is that the Air Force is still investigating. We honestly don't know the answer." One week later, I heard that a top secret unit had been set up at Wright Field to investigate all saucer reports. When I called the Pentagon, they admitted this much, and that was all. In the next few months, other flying disc stories hit the front pages. Two Eastern Airlines pilots reported a double-decked mystery ship sighted near Montgomery, Alabama. I learned of two other sightings, one over the Pacific Ocean and one in California. The second one seemed seen through field glasses was described as a rocket shaped as large as a B-29. And there were also rumors of discs being tracked by radar, but it was almost a year before I confirmed these reports. I'm going to skip ahead a little bit. Keyhoe is an associate of this guy named Purdy. And they are talking about this new special investigation out of Wright Field and this weird stories that are being published by the New York Post. So Wright Field eventually became Wright-Patterson Airfield. It's in or near Dayton, Ohio. I have a buddy who was actually stationed there when he was in the Air Force. And when I first met him, I kept bugging him. I'm like, do you know where Hangar 18 is? Have you ever been to Hangar 18? Back to this Purdy thing. Who wrote the Post story? Purdy lit a cigarette and frowned out again at the skyscrapers. Sidney Shallet. And he's careful. He had four stalls backing. The Air Force flew him around, arranged interviews, supposedly gave him inside stuff. He spent 2 months on it. They had okayed his script, which practically said the saucers are bunk. They're bunk, see? They reneged on it. Maybe some top brass suddenly decided it was the wrong policy to brush it off, I suggested. Why the quick change, demanded Purdy. Let's say they sold the Post on covering up the truth in the interest of security. Well, we all know that the Post is CIA controlled. I mean, we've established and proved that over and over again. It's possible, though, I don't believe it, or they could simply fed them a fake story. Either way, why did they rush this contradiction the minute the Post hit the stands? Something serious happened, I said, after the Post went to press. Yes, but what? Purdy said impatiently. That's what we've got to find out. Does Shallet's first piece mention Mantell's death? It explains it perfectly. You know that Mantell was chasing the planet Venus? Venus. That's the Post answer, I said incredulously. All right, so I'm going to reread it. That's the Post answer, I said incredulously. It was the Air Force contract astronomer told Shallet. I've checked with two astronomers here, and they say that even when Venus is at full magnitude, you can barely see it in the daytime, even when you're looking for it. And it was only half magnitude that day, so it was practically invisible. How did the Air Force expect anybody to believe that answer? I said. Purdy shrugged. They deny it was Venus in the report. But that's what they told Shallet. That all those Air Force officers, the pilots in Kentucky, state police, the several hundred people at Madisonville mistook Venus for a metallic disc several hundred feet in diameter. It's a wonder Shallet believed it. I don't think he did, he said. If it wasn't Venus, it must have been a balloon. What's the Air Force's answer? I asked Purdy. Look in the report. They say whatever Mantell chased, he called it a mysterious object, is still unidentified. I glanced through the case report. On page 5, it quoted Mantell's radio report that the thing was metallic and tremendous in size. Linked with the death of Mantell was the Lockburn, Ohio report, which tied in with what Jack Daly had told me over a year before I read the report. So now we're reading this report. On the same day, about 2 hours later, a sky phenomenon was observed by several watchers over Lockburn Air Force Base, Columbus, Ohio. It was described as a round or oval larger than a C-47 and traveling in level flight faster than 500 miles per hour. The object was followed from Lockburn Observation Tower for more than 20 minutes. Observers said that it glowed from white to amber, leaving an amber exhaust trail 5 times its own length. And it made motions like an elevator. And at one time it appeared to touch the ground. No sound was heard. And finally the object faded and lowered towards the horizon. Purdy buzzed for a secretary, and she brought me a copy of the first Post article. You can get a copy of the Air Force report in Washington, Purdy told me. This was the only one I have, but you'll find the same answer for most of the important cases. The sightings at Muroc Air Force Base, the airline pilots reports, the discs Kenneth Arnold saw. They're all unidentified. I remember the Arnold case and that first sighting. And now, ladies and gentlemen, we have come full circle.
Learn more at abracast.com. Get bonus content and access to the private Abracast workgroup by signing up for the mailing list. Get all that plus many exclusive episodes by supporting the show at patreon.com or subscribestar.com.
Even the former leader of your United States of America, James Earl Carter Jr., thought he saw a UFO once. But it's been proven he only saw the planet Venus.
I'm a Republican.
Venus was at its peak brilliance last night. You probably thought you saw something up in the sky other than Venus. But I assure you, it was Venus.
I know. What I saw.
Your scientists have yet to discover how neural networks create self-consciousness, let alone how the human brain processes two-dimensional retinal images into the three-dimensional phenomenon known as perception. Yet you somehow brazenly declare seeing is believing? Mr. Crickenson, your scientific illiteracy makes me shudder. And I wouldn't flaunt your ignorance by telling anyone that you saw anything last night other than the planet Venus. Because if you do, you're a dead man.
You can't threaten me.
I just did.
I just kind of spoiled it, I guess. Whenever I talk about Venus on the show, I go, oh, Venus. I'm not sure if it's too much of an inside joke.
Are you interested in the occult, history, conspiracy, and violence? Learn more at abracast.com. Find more episodes on this topic. Sign up for the mailing list for bonus content. Get access to the show archive. And visit the storefront for tarot cards, merch, and books. Learn more at abracast.com.
All right, back to this book. For more than 2 weeks, I checked. I'm only telling you that because it's a Fellowcraft episode. I'm not telling the other people that. For more than 2 weeks, I checked on the Goldman Field tragedy. One fact stood out at the start. The death of Mantell had a profound effect on many in the Air Force. A dozen times I was told. I thought the saucers were a joke until Mantell was killed. chasing that thing at Fort Knox. Many ranking officers who had laughed at the saucer scare stopped scoffing. One of these was General Sory Smith, who now Deputy Director of the Air Force Public Relations. Later in my investigation, General Smith told me it was the Mantell case that got me. I knew Tommy Mantell very well. Also Colonel Hicks, the CO at Goldman or at Godman. I knew they were both intelligent men, not the kind to be imagining things. For 15 months, the Air Force kept a tight-lipped silence. Meantime, the rumors began to spread, and one report said that Mantell had been shot, his body riddled with bullets, his P-51 also riddled and simply disintegrated. Another rumor reported Mantell as having been killed by some mysterious force. The same force had also destroyed his fighter. The Air Force, the rumors said, had covered up the truth by telling Mantell's family that he had blacked out from the lack of oxygen. We're going to get to more of that later. Checking the last angle, I found that this was the explanation given to Mantell's mother just after his death. He was told by Standiford Field officer, she was told by Standiford Field officers that he had flown too high and chasing the strange object. Shallot in the Saturday Evening Post articles described Project Saucer's reconstruction of the case. Mantell was said to have climbed up to 25,000 feet despite the firm decision to end the chase at 20,000. Since he carried no oxygen. Around 25,000 feet, Shallot quoted the Air Force investigators. Mantell must have lost consciousness after this. His pilotless plane climbed up on to some 30,000 feet and then dived between 20 and 10,000 feet. Shallot suggested the P-51 began to disintegrate, obviously, from the excessive speed. The gleaming object that hypnotized Mantell into his fatal climb was, Shallot said, either the planet Venus or a Navy cosmic ray research balloon. Ah, the old research balloon trick. The Air Force Project Saucer report of April 27, 1949, released just after the First Post article, makes these statements. 5 minutes after Mantell's disappearance from his formation, the two remaining planes returned to Godman. A few minutes later, one resumed the search, covering territory 100 miles to the south, as high as 30,000 feet, but found nothing. We read as much at the beginning of this episode. Subsequent investigations revealed that Mantell had probably blacked out at 20,000 feet from his lack of oxygen, and he had died of suffocation before the crash. The mysterious object which the flyer chased to his death was first identified as the planet Venus. However, further probing showed the elevation and azimuth reading of Venus at the object at specified time intervals did not coincide. It is still considered unidentified. I like that one. Dun, 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 dun. The Venus explanation, even though now denied, puzzled me. The Venus explanation, even though now denied, puzzled me. It was plain that the Air Force had seriously considered offering it as an answer, then abandoned it. Apparently, someone had got his signals mixed and let Shallot use the discarded answer. For some unknown reason, the Air Force had found it imperative to deny the Venus story at once. In these first weeks of checking, I had run into the Venus explanation. In other cases, several Air Force officers repeated it so quickly that it had the sound of a stock alibi. But in the daytime cases was almost ridiculous. I knew for a few instances in World War II when bomber crews and aircraft gunners had loosed a few bursts at Venus, but this was mostly at night and the planet was at its peak brilliance. And more than one gunner later admitted to fire to relieve long hours of boredom. Since enemy planes did not carry lights, there was no authentic case to my knowledge where a plane or ground gunner actually believed Venus was an enemy aircraft. Checking to the astronomer's report, I read over the concluding statements. It simply could not have been Venus. They must have been desperate even to suggest it in the first place. Months later, in the secret project saucer report released December 30th, 1949, I found official confirmation on the astronomer's opinion, since it has been a peculiar bearing on the Mantell case. I'm quoting it now. When Venus is at its greatest brilliance, it is possible to see it during the daytime when one knows exactly where to look. But on January 7th, 1948, Venus was less than half as brilliant as its peak brilliance. However, under exceptionally good atmospheric conditions and with the eye shielded from direct rays of the sun, Venus might be seen as exceedingly tiny, bright point of light. However, the chances of looking at just the right spot are very few. It has been unofficially reported that the object was a Navy cosmic ray research balloon. If this can be established, it is to be preferred as an explanation. However, if one accepts the assumption that the reports from various other localities refer to the same object, any such device must be good many miles high, 25 to 50, in order to have seen it clearly almost simultaneously from places 170 miles apart. If all reports were of a single object, in the knowledge of the investigator, no man-made object could have been large enough and far enough away to the approximate simultaneous sightings. It is almost unlikely that so many separate persons could, at that time, have chanced on Venus in the daylight sky. It appears, therefore, much more probable that more than one object was involved. The sighting might have included two or more balloons or aircraft, or they might have included Venus and balloons for reasons given above. The later explanation seems more likely. So we're gonna effectively end the show. If you wanna. You know, if you're tuning in to listen to the puzzling death, the puzzling demise of Captain Mantell, this is kind of where our story ends. So we're going to end it here. We're going to unhook you if you want, but I am going to continue and we're going to speculate about UFOs a little bit. Now, some of you guys that have been listening for a long time probably have pieced together that I'm kind of skeptical about these items. However, I have a, I guess it would be, I have a close encounter of the second kind. I've actually seen a UFO. And so we're going to end the show, but I'm going to continue to talk. I'm going to tell my UFO story. It's funny because as skeptical as I am about some of this stuff, I have like actual witness experience with it. Like, don't get me started on a Bigfoot. I have a Bigfoot story that I'm never, ever going to tell. But I am going to tell this story. It's a personal, true story. I'm going to tell it because it has actually a lot. It has some ties, some connections, some commonality with this Mantell story. I don't know if anyone fucking died. But yeah, so we'll end it here. And if you made it to this point, then thank you so much. But if you want to listen to some UFO speculation and a true story, then join me after this this little drone here, and we'll finish this up, okay? So I'm John. This has been the Abercast. Thank you so much for your support and this Fellowcraft episode, the puzzling death of Captain Mantell. And yeah, so that's it. Thank you very much. I hope you guys are enjoying the content. I do this every fucking time.
Thank you for listening to this episode. Send an email or visit us on social media to let us know what you think about this topic. And please remember to leave a 5-star rate and review.
All right. So if you're still here, then welcome to, I don't know what to call this. Welcome to this. But I'm going to tell a personal story about a UFO, me witnessing a UFO. And it's not too different from our former president, James Earl Carter Jr. So I grew up in a bunch of shitty places, and I haven't really talked about it on the show, but I've kind of hinted about it. If you're like, why is this kid hanging out in libraries all the time? It's because I didn't want to fucking go home. So one of the places, the worst place I lived ever growing up was Marietta, Georgia. I was in elementary school. I was one of only 6 white kids at this school. So anyhow, this is not even about that. But another of the places that I lived was like a diametrically opposed version of that. It's a place called Wellington, Ohio. It's not even a suburb of a suburb of a suburb of anywhere. It's this shitty, to me, it was shitty. I'm sure it's full of fine people. And I'm sure under different circumstances, I would love to visit. But, when I was a kid, I was a bit of a, I mean, I know this is going to be a shocker for everybody, but I was a bit of a nerd. So I didn't really fit in anywhere, especially in this fucking farm town. Like when the movie Footloose came out, I was like, I can totally relate to this, except I can't dance. I can't even dance. Anyhow, so I was living in Wellington, Ohio. Go Dukes. The maroon and white fight, fight. And, I hated it. I hated every second of it. I hated my home life. My dad was married to this. Oh, I need to restrict what I say. My dad was married to this bitch, and I hated her. Anyhow, he's been married like 3 times. My mom's been married 4 times. Her third husband passed away. Anyhow, it's very difficult to keep control of. And like, you have to like worry about fucking birthday cards and fucking the logistics of visiting home for the holidays is crazy. Anyhow, I'm just babbling at this point. So my old man had a car. It was like a black Dodge, and it had kind of like this beta spoiler on it. I can't even remember what kind of car it was. It might have had like some kind of weird scoop in the front and like these like a weird kind of like bait, like a tiny dick kind of spoiler on the back of it. And it was enough for me to be like, okay, this is close to a Transit. So like my dream car is like the Smokey and the Bandit Trans Am. Like that's what I had. I had something pretty close. I mean, relatively speaking, I owned a 93 Camaro. We had the big block in it. It was the first of the new body. It was one of the first of the new body type. And I loved it. I loved the hot rod. I had to get rid of it because I couldn't support the maintenance on it. But anyhow, I'm tying this back because this is the I remember this so vividly because I kind of was like, this car's pretty cool. Like, it has like an angled nose, so it's basically like a Trans Am in my brain. I was probably in middle school when this all shook down. So Wellington is newsworthy, noteworthy for one thing, as far as I'm concerned, is it had like the third, when McDonald's opened in it, it was like one of the third biggest fucking McDonald's grand opening of in the history of the United States of America. people came from hundreds of miles around. They suffered through, traversing through hundreds of miles of cornfields and whatnot and cow shit and everything to get to this McDonald's on the day that it opened. Like, I mean, I haven't checked in on it recently, but like that was the big news. And this was way before that even happened. It's like they had like a grand opening the night before for like the mayor and like, like it was just silly. Anyhow, so we were driving down like the one main road. It was probably called Main Street. I don't know. If you like Google Map Wellington, Ohio, you'll see the road I'm talking about. It's like the one road. There's like four blocks of like the quote town unquote whatever. So we were going that. We were driving down. And the old man pulls over and he's like hanging out of the window looking up at the sky. And so I look out and I see like this crazy light in the sky. And I'm like, what is that crazy light? And I'd always been interested in UFOs. In the episode I mentioned about reading this, I had this book like this. It's like Time Life or Reader's Digest or something, like Mysteries of the Unknown Mysteries of the Universe. Anyhow, it's just, I actually should bring it down here to use it a little bit more. But, about Kenneth Arnold, I remember being plugged when I was a kid. I was plugged into the UFO phenomenon, and specifically the abduction. I watched like an In Search Of or something like that about alien abduction, and I was terrified. I probably didn't sleep for like 3 days. I was terrified. Anyhow, I feel like I'm spinning out of control, but it's okay because the show's over. This is like an after show chit chat. So, anyhow, I'm struggling to look out the window to see this weird light my old man's looking at, and he gets out of the car. And so I like start to get out of the car, 'cause I'm like, I'm going to look at this UFO too. And he's like, no, Johnny, stay in the car. And I'm like, I don't want to stay in the car. So anyhow, I stayed in the car. I was afraid of the old man's belt. So, I stayed in the car and I looked. Like, I crawled into the back where, like, this, if you know what kind of, I think it was a Dodge. If you know what kind of Dodge I'm talking about, it had this real big, like, hatch kind of back window. So I crawled in the back and I was watching the sky through this giant back windshield part, like this through the hatchback. When you think about hatchbacks now, you think like little tiny wide windows. This thing had like a kind of a square window. I got a pretty good picture. And we were sitting there and he was outside looking out. There was other people started to like park on the shoulder of the road and getting out and looking up at the sky as well. And everyone was just looking. And then all of a sudden we saw jets going in the same direction as we saw this weird light going, and they were like streaking. They were like fucking getting after it. You know, they weren't, it wasn't all like a helicopter or anything. It was like a jet getting after it in the same, there were two of them getting after it in the same direction where this weird, the UFO light went. And I remember being like, man, someone's fucking, these guys are fucking chasing a UFO. Like, that's crazy. And I think I'm telling this story tonight because of this story of Captain Thomas Mantell. You know, that he lost his life also. He also lost his life chasing an unidentified flying object. I'm not laughing at him. I'm laughing at the amount of fun I'm having with these new sound bits. So the reason I brought it up is because of the likelihood or whatever, like the mirroring of the issues of these things. So I don't know if they ever caught it. I don't know if it just disappeared. I've never seen like a Project Blue Book report on it. It must have been super high up in the air. I've never seen like a MUFON report on it. I've never seen really anything about it, other than my old man's wonder. Like, he was like terrified, but he was captivated by it. We must have sat on the side of the road for like 20-30 minutes, and people were like parking up behind us to get out and look at it. It was totally like right out of Close Encounters of the Third Kind. And I'll never forget like being in the back. All like the interior was like red, like that red plastic, and then like the shitty like short indoor outdoor carpet kind of texture to like the interior of them. I'll never forget being in the back of that car looking up through the window at the UFO. You know, it was amazing. So that's my UFO story. You're never going to get the Bigfoot story out of me. You're never going to get it. It's like in Vogue. You're never going to get it. 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 So I'm John. This has been the Abercast, and this is the real ending of the show. So thank you guys for all of your support if you're hanging in there. And I'd like to hear what you think about this Jesse Mantell, or I keep saying Jesse Mantell, this Captain Thomas Mantell business. Have you heard of this? Have you heard of this before? Have you read this book? Apparently it's a pretty popular book for UFO people. And yeah, so that's it. I'm John. This is the Abercast. See ya. We'll do this one more time.
Thank you for listening to this episode. Send an email or visit us on social media to let us know what you think about this topic. And please remember to leave a 5-star rate and review. Thank you for listening, and we hope that you enjoyed the show. Please send an email or find us on social media and let us know what you think about the show. We would appreciate it if you would give us a 5-star rate and review wherever you find your favorite podcasts. You can find Stigmata Studios graphic novels and comic books at abercast.com.